Hello, everyone, and welcome to a TV Party Tonight Extra Wrestling Commentaries. This is a new thing that we're doing. It's come out of our Remembering Bruno Sammartino podcast that we did. If you'll recall, myself, Mark Radulich, and my good friend Pat Mullin commentated over a Bruno Sammartino Superstar Billy Graham match. And, you know, we both caught the bug for wanting to do more of these. You know, way back in the day, we actually used to do UFC pay-per-view commentaries, but I don't have 18 hours anymore to sit and commentate over those things. So we're going to dial it back a little bit, and we're going to start bringing you some individual match commentaries. This is the first one that we're doing, and we thought we'd start right off the beaten path. But first, let me introduce my commentator co-host. Ladies and gentlemen, he's the punchy pugilist, totally 80s, Pat Mullin. How do you do, sir?
Good evening, Mark. Good evening, listeners. I am excited for this. This is a fun thing we haven't gotten to really try out yet in such a professional manner. We really have our game on for this one. We've done some watch-alongs. We've done some live commentaries. But this is one where we really are on the same page. We're seeing everything at the same time. It's beautiful. We can speak to you. We're all listening at the same rate. We're going to have some fun with this. We hope you do, too.
All right. Very well said. So, as I said, we're going to go off the beaten path here with our first match. I don't know if people listening may remember the WWE experimented with Tough Man contests as brought to you by Swerve, brah, Mr. One Vince Russo. They called it the Brawl for All, and it was really a cockamamie way to get Dr. Death Steve Williams over, and unfortunately Dr. Death got knocked the fuck out during the Brawl for All, so it kind of all went to hell. But along the way we had some unexpectedly fun nonsense matches in the Brawl for All, and this is going to be one of them. This is three rounds of just haymakers and hallelujahs. This is Bart Gunn versus the Godfather. So get ready for this, folks. It's going to be a bond burner, as Jim Ross would say. Right, Pat?
It'll be a good old-fashioned slobber knocker featuring a guy who, if nothing else, is going to be famous for his involvement in this more so than anything else in Bart Gunn. And it's funny because when this concept was talked about, a lot of people talked about what a bad idea it was within the WWE internally because of it. And once the participants were announced, everybody was kind of wondering who was going to take who. And Bart wasn't one of the favorites other than to maybe one or two people. One of those people was Terry Funk. When they announced the tournament and everything, Terry Funk looked at who was in it, and he just sat there kind of minding his own business and goes, "That cowboy gun is going to win the whole damn thing."
Someday Bruce Pritchard's going to retire from podcasting, and I hope they just hire you to replace him. Still call it Something to Wrestle with Bruce Pritchard, but you'll just be playing the part of Bruce Pritchard because you can do all of his imitations.
I'm okay, but I can't. But then I can't, you know, like you. If it's me and you play the Conrad role, Mark, I can't. You can't say anything about your lovely wife, who I happen to like, because then I have to just come out and say she's a whore.
It's one thing about Melissa, and I can't blame her for this. She probably doesn't want to be called a whore on a regular basis. All right. With that said, I'm going to go ahead and hit play. We are using the watchtogether.com website, and this broadcasts a variety of different videos from a variety of different sources to both of our terminals. So that's kind of why we're starting to do this. We're like, wow, we found this website. It was brought to me by Jesse Starcher, and we're like, oh, this is going to be fun. Let's do more of it. So here we go. All right, so we begin with a moments ago, there looked like Ken Shamrock was getting in the face of Sergeant Slaughter. We see the Brawl for All logo coming up, and out walks, and he's ready for battle, the Godfather with his hose. You know, I'm so used to watching like UFC fights that it seems strange that he looks like he's just walking out in like regular workout clothes, and he doesn't have advertisements or Reebok all over him.
No, the closest he's got is the Nike swoosh on the shorts, and yeah. he's got his three ladies of the night with him. Three ladies, and between them, there ain't 3 yards worth of clothing. Oh, the Attitude Era.
We miss you so. On the phone, the president. Oh, boy. That is a lot of cleavage. My goodness.
And here comes that cowboy.
You would think that in producing the segment, someone would have told them, wear different color clothing. Don't both be wearing plain black. Jesus Christ.
No, at least the Godfather kind of has, you know, he's wearing, you know, just a tank top with some kind of, looks like a tattoo shop logo on it. And we're seeing last night's episode of Sunday Night Heat, which they tried to make an angle before a real fight happened between the Godfather and Bart. And Godfather's on the mic and making an offer that if you haven't watched the Attitude Era at all and you're not familiar with this, Godfather is a pimp. And Godfather oftentimes would offer one of his or more of his, depending on the opponent, ladies of the night, in exchange for not having to fight. Well, Bart's kind of an 80s B-movie hero in this, in that he doesn't say much, he looks real good, and he's dressed in very plain clothing, but he's going to fight the fight.
Yes, he is. I have to say, going into this, this is in the wake of the new Midnight Express. You know, his career has been on just a downswing, and going into it, I'm sure people thought he was cannon fodder on the way to getting Steve Williams over, and he walked in this thing with a real chip on his shoulder, because he knew how talented he was. I mean, not talented enough to get knocked the fuck out by Butterbean, but that's a whole other story.
And we get the tail of the tape to make it official. Significant advantages would be Godfather is 60 pounds heavier, 2 inches taller, and has a 3-inch reach, and we're off and running.
Mm-hmm. All right. The Godfather started off with not a bad jab, but he immediately just kind of lost it and started throwing hooks and whatnot. Bart Gunn goes for a single leg. I was trying to teach Jonas this the other day, how to go for takedowns, which is, you know, slight disadvantage. I'm a 300-pound man at 5'9", and he's not.
And Godfather, you know, he was at least before fatigue set in a little bit, because these guys aren't used to having to actually fight. But Godfather was keeping his right hand up, you know, glued to his chin, because Bart had been making his left hand a little bit notorious in this tournament. But he's starting to connect now, because... Oh, and Godfather's firing back, too. Godfather's got a karate background.
Godfather scored one on the chin there. Really shook Bart up a bit, but, you know, he took it. The problem was Bart really lost all of his form. He's just throwing arm punches really early on. And the thing of it is he's got some technique. He just chose not to use it in that first round.
No, it's one of those things where, and you'll see highlights here where he kind of gets the clubber in a little bit.
Right.
And Godfather, you know, you talked about the good jab he pointed out there. And he did land a good right hand at the end of the round that kind of stung Bart. And there's a replay of it again. A lot of times it's funny how if a guy isn't used to getting hit, they kind of react a little funny. And they're going to give round one to the Godfather, to Bart Gunn, excuse me. Points are 5-0 because Bart landed the most punches in a round, according to them, which is worth 5 points.
He's going to go for a double this time. And, you know, and that's a nice sprawl by the Godfather, the old dick in the dirt.
Yeah, Godfather is using that height and reach to keep out of the grappling range there, so Bart can't take him down and get a quick 10 points, or 5 points, excuse me. But Bart's now got him against the ropes. He ran out of real estate, and now we're seeing some haymakers being thrown. But the Godfather has him cornered. He turned back, farred up, and now he's going to work.
That was a nice spin in the corner there. He turned out of the corner, pushed Bart right in. I think Bart's also winded. I don't think he's got quite the boxing breathing down. Just weird for a guy used to do tough man competitions, but...
We see the mouths open and breathing. Godfather doing a little bit of holding and hanging corner, which is not illegal, but Bart landed a big left, and now he's just hammering away with the left hand, and we have Roadhouse.
Yes, here we go. Roadhouse. Yeah. Oh!
And a left hand!
Knocks down the Godfather.
At the bell, put down on the seat of his pants, and he gets up on some very unsteady legs.
He's got spaghetti legs there. He's starting to wonder what he got himself into. But yeah, I mean, this is where you start to see how much conditioning and breathing play a pivotal role in boxing. Because when you can't breathe, you can't keep your arms up, you can't keep your form, and you allow yourself to get hit by just somebody winging punches at your face.
And these guys are very big, meaty, and muscular. They have much more meat on the bicep area and the tricep area, which when you get to going, those arms are big and nice, but they get harder to hold up. And based on the knockdown, which is worth 10 points, and most punches landed, which is worth 5, even though I don't think he landed more punches, Bart is now unofficially ahead 20-0 on the scorecards. Basically, and we're in the last round, Godfather's going to need a knockout here.
And it's not going to come easy. Well, of course, you know how this ends, but... Whoa! Good night, Gracie. The Godfather is down for the count. And Vince McMahon has thrown his headset.
Despite the angle to set up an injured Bart the night before, Bart Gunn with the two-piece, a winging left hand that got him a little bit behind the ear and not flush, but he made sure to come back with a big right hook, and to sleep went the Godfather.
Oh, that was right on the jaw, Pat. I mean, yeah, it doesn't... Jesus Christ.
The whiplash on the neck, and face down.
Yeah, you actually saw... That was almost cartoonish. You actually saw the jaw kind of just move from side to side from the impact. A very impressive win by one Bart Gunn. And I'm sure Godfather went into this going, you know what? You know, I'm sure I'll be able to hold my own against this guy. I'll be all right. And he got his ass handed to him.
Here's perhaps the best part is Bart going over and having a little conversation with one Jim Ross, who it is well established and known that Jim Ross was heavily banking on one Dr. Death Steve Williams in this tournament to go ahead and win. And... when Bart pretty much put him to sleep and his WWF career to sleep, Jim Ross was not too happy about it, and Bart kind of driving the point home there that it wasn't a fluke that he beat Dr. Death.
Now, Bart's going to go on to win this whole thing and then get knocked out and summarily fired.
He knocks out another one of Jim Ross's boys in Bradshaw.
And then, like I said, WrestleMania 15, I don't think he lasted an entire round with Butterbean before he got flattened. I was there live for that.
I was not there live, but I was watching it with, to this day, still my best friend. And that was one of the ones where we were like, I wonder if Bart has a legitimate chance, because if he tries to take him down, he probably can. And instead, people had Bart believing that he was a boxer, and he got destroyed real quick.
Yeah, you could actually see Bart Gunn's soul rising as his body lay flat and dead.
Yeah, and no knock on Bart. I don't think anybody in this tournament who would have gone in and tried to box with Butterbean would have come out any better than Bart did.
Agreed. All right, Pat, that was fun. I think we're going to call it an evening, but we'll, as I said to Pat, anytime he has a burning desire and some time on his hands, we'll go ahead and put these up like we do with the Metal Hammer of Doom extras. Pat, you want to plug anything real quick?
What do I got going on? Well, I don't have too much going on other than the stuff I usually do with Mark and the 411 Ground and Pound radio show every Sunday at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. However, I will let everyone know that as of today, Chris Evans has pretty much finished building his new studio. We have some content lined up. The Casual Heroes are returning, folks.
It's very exciting. They'll be a part of two different podcast networks. The Radulich and Broadcasting and the Casual Heroes. Your time will be split. You'll be a wanted man.
Why should anything change?
All right, Pat, thank you for doing this with me tonight. Like I said, we'll do these with a little bit more regularity. We have just decades and decades of matches to pour through. There's so much on the internet for us to take a look at and enjoy talking about. So we'll do this again soon. So for the Punchy Pugilist, Totally 80s Pat Mullin, I'm your mandated reporter and frankly unmortified Mr. Mark Radulich. This has been a TV Party Tonight Extra. Bart Gunn versus the Godfather Brawl for All. Be well, be safe, and behave.